A warm welcome from the people of Menzelinsk and a highly colourful opening ceremony greeted over 80 competitors to the latest running of the FAI Parachuting and Skydiving World Championships. Held every 2 years, the World Championship unites the best competition skydivers and parachutists with teams travelling from right across Europe, Australia, North and South America, Asia and South Africa.
Good luck.
This latest event incorporated world championships for three different disciplines, including formation skydiving and artistic skydiving. But it's the sport of canopy formation, upon which we're going to focus in this first report from Menzelinsk.
Canopy formation is when we jump out of the plane at 6,000 feet and we open up our parachutes straight away.
And they make formations with their parachutes. They've got to join up by actually touching the other person's parachute to make a formation.
There's a two-way event and there's two four-way events. The two-way event, again, there's a series of formations that they repeat over and over. The four-way, one of them is like that, and the other four-way is they build a stack of four canopies, so everybody joins up one on top of the other. Then the person on the top hops off the top, goes down the back and has to join onto the bottom, and that's called rotation.
The top guy leaves and goes round to the bottom, and that's 1 point. And when he's at the bottom, the top guy leaves and goes round, and that's another point. And they do that for a certain amount of working time, and the one with the most points of course will win. Then there's also something called sequential. Then they do different kinds of figures, so they do like five different kinds of figures in one jump, and in another jump there's another five different kinds of figures.
I'm in the two-way sequential event, so there's three of us in the team. Two of us are making formations with our parachutes and our cameraman flies behind and videos it all.
The performers make formations that are drawn by the judges for us to go up and perform. We have a sequence of five points that they've drawn out. We have to repeat those as many times as we can in the 1 minute's working time we've got. That 1 minute starts either 30 seconds after the first performer leaves the door or when we break the first point.
So those are the rules, but with the competition unravelling thousands of feet in the air and the officials down on terra firma, how is it possible to keep track of the scores?
Each team needs to provide their own camera flyer, who has to be just as experienced really as a team competitor themselves, and these people are eligible for medals as well. Their job is to record the performance for the judges.
So it's his job and the team's job to actually present the correct formations to the judges. So when he's landed, he takes all his equipment, he goes over to the dubbing station and he downloads his skydive.
Then the cameraman, or woman, could be a woman as well, goes to the dubbing station and downloads the video to a DVD. The judges look at the DVD, and they also have an electronic scoring system, so they have five boxes with buttons on and their boxes are connected to a computer. So the video starts rolling and they press the point for every figure the team is doing. And at the end of working time, when the 35 seconds for instance is gone, the video freezes and then the computer calculates the scores.
With 10 different countries represented at this 14th running of the World Championships, canopy formation has truly become an international sport. But which nations have the best record in terms of results?
You've always got to look for the big three, Russia, USA and France. They're always up there at the top. They've got good coaching programs in those countries and they support the sport very well. But there's some outsiders. There's a team from Australia in the canopy formation event, a team of 2A people. They in the first round, they're in second place, and it's a big eye-opener to a lot of people.
A good start to the competition then for the Australians, as they and the rest of the teams prepare to head up to altitude for the third round of the competition. Across the course of 3 days, each team would get 8 jumps, with their best 7 scores to count towards the final total. The opening round of the two-way sequential competition had gone to form, with the USA taking an early lead. But the Australians had matched their score in round 2, leaving the USA just 1 point clear as they went into this third round. But with the pressure on, they put together their best jump so far, scoring 22 points to move on to a total of 58. Round three proved slightly disappointing for the Australians with 19 points. Not only did they score three less than the Americans, but they're also beaten by Russia and France. But with 54 points, they remained second. With two teams entered, France were expected to challenge for the medals here, and after a steady start, their number one team really brought themselves into contention with 20 points in round three. Their best sequence yet, putting them third overall on 50 points. With double the amount of parachutists to try and manoeuvre, the number of sequences completed in four-way is roughly half of what the two-way teams manage. So you might expect the points to be tighter, but in fact the USA dominated. After just three rounds, they had twice as many points as anyone else. While the USA were romping clear on 34 points, it was neck and neck in the battle for second place. The French team on 17 points, with the Russians matching them every step of the way. Both teams well clear of the Netherlands, who were fourth overall. And in the four-way rotation championships, the Russians were again doing well on home territory, or should that be above home territory? With 62 points, they were on track for the gold medal. But it was tight, just 2 points behind them on 60 were the French. And in fact, the French had matched the Russians in each of the last two rounds. And next up were the Belarusian team, just 5 points off the lead. So as you've seen, the role of camera fly is critical to the success of the teams. Craig Bennett now performs that role for Australia in two-way sequential.
The main thing that I try and do is I try and stay close enough so that the judges can't miss what we're doing. So I try and stay right up their bum so that all you can see is the foot and the line of the parachute that's taking the grip. So there's no excuses for the judges not to give us a point. It'd be nothing worse than doing a good skydive and the judges can't see what's going on, so you don't actually get the points. This is my camera helmet. It's just a helmet with a high-definition camera sitting on the top here. I record it basically onto a memory chip, which is inside here. I used to use tape, but as technology has evolved, then we're using memory chips now, so there's less moving parts, there's less possibility of having a glitch within working time that would mean that we might have to go up and do the jump again or something like that. For sighting, I've just got a couple of little dots here, which is my secret little coding dots, and I know where I need to put those on the performance to make sure that that grip's right in there.
But skill isn't the only consideration. The sport also relies on having a particular set of weather conditions.
We want nice, stable air, smooth air, so a day like today when there's no clouds and there's not much wind is perfect for us. As soon as it starts to heat up in the middle of the day, it gets really turbulent and our discipline actually stops. So we're just jumping from 8 till 12. And then we have a break and start up again in the afternoon from 4 because it tends to be much more stable air at those times of the day.
As you've seen, canopy formation requires a great deal of skill, but how much practice does it take to reach this level?
To get to this level in the sport, it's not easy. It's a hard road. You need to put a lot of practice in, which means using wind tunnels often these days, training together with team members, getting to be able to work together properly as a team. So there's a lot required. There wouldn't be many competitors with less than 2,000 jumps here. There would be plenty with over 10,000 jumps experience. So you can see it's quite a broad range, but it's all high experience.
We've done about 200 jumps in the last couple of months, and we actually jumped from 14,000 feet. Even though we do our competition from 6,000, from 14,000 we get a lot more repetition and also a lot more stamina, so when we come to competition, 6,000 is easy. Yeah, so that's really cool.
After setting the pace, the USA went on to extend their lead in two-way sequential, taking the gold medal with 135 points, averaging over 19 points per round. Australia remained strong and took a surprise silver medal on 124, while the Russians shook off the French to take bronze. In four-way sequential, the USA won 6 of the 8 rounds to comfortably take the gold medal with 72 points. The Russians were the strongest team in the final two rounds, and that was enough to give them the silver medal by just 2 points from the French. American domination was finally broken in four-way rotation, where Russia took the gold medal. In the closest fought contest of the championships, they finished just 2 points clear of France. Belarus rounding out the medals. A highly successful competition then, and not just in terms of the action above the ground.
Well, traditionally, our parachute championships were held at little airfields around the world, whichever aero club or skydiving club would volunteer to host them. We've realised that they're now quite a big event and they attract a lot of people and a lot of sponsors are involved. And we're now looking to partner with cities, towns and so on who want to attract an exciting event. We were a bit, I suppose, reluctant to have a competition so far away from mainstream the rest of the world. This is a long way from anywhere. Even Moscow's over 1,000 kilometres away. Being here in Menzelinsk has been a really good example for us. To see the support provided by the country, both federal, state and local to not only this competition but to the neighbouring town and the industries and so on. It's a real pleasure to see. The town's been given new gutters and curbs and buildings have been painted, they've got new supermarkets, there's new infrastructure, there's more employment, and it's great to know that the event that I'm involved in has been helping somebody else's life.
Congratulations then to all competitors that took part in the 14th FAI World Canopy Formation Championships. And remember, we'll be back in Russia for a look at the formation skydiving and artistic skydiving later in the series.